Welcome to Harmonia. This is a visual novel by the studio Key, famous for emotionally heavy visual novels such as Planetarian, Clannad, Little Busters. I believe Angel Beats as well. I believe that's also a Key production. Let's go ahead and start. Let's get reading. Because I like reading. It began with an unnatural beep. A pale light suffused my vision. I first saw the light a few seconds prior. Or perhaps it was a few hundred years ago. Nothing else had changed much. I wondered when I started seeing the light. I wondered when I would stop seeing the light. Ideas flowed through my vague consciousness. I wondered how many times it had been. I wondered how many more times I would think these thoughts. Unconsciously, I extended my arms toward the pale light. Was something ending? Was something beginning? I didn't know, of course. Even so, I remained hopeful and continued to extend both arms toward the light. Now, this is my first time reading through the visual novel. It is on sale on Steam for $4, so I figure, hey, it's Key, it's $4, why not? Then, the air moved. The pale light which had once surrounded me began to recede, and the next thing I saw was a filthy ceiling. Both my right and left arms were extended toward the ceiling, but the right was a little different. My right arm was mechanical, and some components were poking out from the wrist. The fingers moved smoothly, but as they did, I could hear the gentle reverberation of metal scraping against metal. I began to sit up, slowly. Finally, I realized that the pale light which had consumed my vision came from the softly curved oblong lid which was before me. Apparently, I had been asleep in this capsule-like thing. Where was I? Who was I? Why was I here? Asking these questions to myself provided no answers. In an attempt to trace back my own memories, all I could recall was that pale light. Hoping to find even the smallest hint about my memories, I climbed down from the capsule and began to wander around the room. Even though I knew how to walk, I must not have done it for a long time. My legs were unsteady and shaky. Taking great care not to fall over, I slowly continued my walk. The air around me was lukewarm, and each breath I took coated my throat with the dust. Outside light was coming in through the hole in the ceiling, and its path revealed the dust in the air. It seemed as though no one had been in this building for quite some time. A thin layer of dust covered the floor. I wondered what went on in this place. A countless number of those oblong capsules dotted the huge room. The majority of them were open, and they were all empty. Some of them were closed, but even they had nothing inside. It seemed that I was the only one in the room. No, that wasn't exactly true. There were people leaning against the capsules and lying sprawled on the ground. Except something was wrong. You couldn't really call them human. It might be more accurate to call them humanoid objects. The mechanical parts of these humanoid objects could be seen peeking out from beneath their skin. For some, everything above the neck was mechanical. The mechanical arms on some were bare. Some of their lower halves were torn, and their mechanical parts visible. Then I remembered something about these humanoid objects. Phyroids. Made for humans to serve as their partners. They were equipped not only with the five senses, but also emotions in order to be as close as possible to real humans. I reached out my hand to a motionless phyroid. The bare, skinless arm was frighteningly similar to my own. I understood. This was a factory. I was made here. Just before I was completed, this place must have been destroyed for some reason. Before, my right hand was covered with artificial skin. Staring at my mechanical arm, I reached this plausible conclusion. Realizing what I was, I began to walk towards a wall. There were old automatic doors with a dusty LCD reading "closed" next to them. I touched it with my mechanical hand. Just as my bloodless fingertips sensed something cold and electrical, the display changed to read "open" and the doors unsealed. Would I be able to get out this way? I wondered if there was someone remaining in the facility. I wanted to meet them. I wanted to meet a human. To find my partner. I pushed open the doors leading outside, and set out in order to prove my own existence. Once the human population hit its peak of 10 billion, a rapid decline began. Air pollution, water pollution, contamination, abnormal weather, conflicts. The list of causes was endless. During this time, the phyroids were developed. They were deeply emotional partners for humans. Phyroids were originally equipped with batteries, but afterwards an oral energy supply model was developed. They could be powered by eating food. Phyroids became even more human-like as a result, eventually substituting for family or lifetime companions, and the demand continued to rise. Even more importantly, there was no such thing as death for phyroids. Therefore, they were also in high demand for harsh work environments such as hospice care and medicine. They could even be used in places which would be harmful for a human body. The phyroids were happy with this brutal work. After all, phyroids exist to live alongside humans, and to be needed by humans. As I reclaimed this knowledge from the depths of my memory, I walked across the cracked red earth. Having escaped that sand-covered facility, I was faced with a world that differed immensely from the one I knew. The wind swirled the dust around, interfering with both my sight and breathing. The earth I tread upon contained no trace of moisture, and each step created a small cloud of sand. The sky was covered with thick, all-consuming clouds. I could not see a hint of blue. It was so desolate a scene that it could not even be called a wasteland. As far as I could see, there was not a hint of life. Not even plants grew here. It wasn't just the facility I was in that had been abandoned. Something had happened to this area. I came up with several possibilities as I scanned through my knowledge, but found no answer. The occasional downpour would bring with it a rusty smell. In those cases, I took extreme care to make sure rainwater did not enter the glove covering the exposed machinery of my right hand. I had found the glove in the factory. It fit my arm perfectly, and fortunately there was only the slightest bit of space for moisture to make its way inside. What's more, wearing the glove made me look completely human. I wanted to be just like a human. A sudden thought came to me in that moment. This glove was absolutely essential for that purpose. As I shielded myself from the murky raindrops, I consumed one of the emergency oral nutrient blocks that I had taken from the factory. As their only purpose was to efficiently supply energy, they were almost flavorless. Regardless, they were necessary for me to keep taking steps forward. No matter how many steps I took, I did not find the light I was looking for. Judging from the changing brightness of the sky, I had walked for 3 days. Although I had reduced my walking speed to keep energy consumption down, I must have covered a fair distance. But I had not encountered a single human along the way. Nor did I encounter any towns, grass, or other living things. All that lay in front of my eyes was endless red-brown earth. It was too harsh of an environment to support any sort of form of life. Was the world completely destroyed? Had humans become completely extinct? Was I the only thing that remained in the world? Seeds of doubt had been planted within me, and then finally began to sprout. However, I kept walking to dispel that doubt. I walked, and walked, and walked, and walked. I don't know how far I walked. After all, to stop walking would be to lose my reason for existing. After the third squall, I arrived at a place with enough buildings to call a town. I was sure that I would find a human there. I quickened my steps and began to walk through the town. The town had grown old, and all the buildings were badly weathered. All the metals were rusted and everything inside had rotted away. It must have been decades. No, it had been left untended for even longer than that, I thought. I didn't want to think about it. But I couldn't help myself. What if there wasn't a single human here? When my hope began to change into despair, I found myself in front of a store with an enormous showcase. The showcase's glass was broken, and all the goods it had once contained were missing. They had probably been stolen. As I looked over the showcase, I realized something. I could see my reflection in the glass. I looked to be in my mid-teens. I was about 170 centimeters tall. Excluding my gloved right hand, I looked completely human. Although it was hard to call the expression on my face human. Completely transparent and inorganic. In no way could it truly be called an expression. It looked human-like, but it was quite far from human. That is what I saw reflected in the glass. There was no expression, just like a regular old robot. Only something meant to do work. A machine without a soul. But I was a phyroid. Acknowledging my lack of emotions would prove that I was defective. That was unacceptable. Despite being made to be a human's partner, I could never fulfill the role. If that were the case, my existence was without merit. Having been activated, I wanted to be useful for humans. However, I would probably need emotions if I were to do so. If I could learn emotions, if I could do that, would I be able to return to an existence worth of a phyroid? Bit of a typo there, I guess. If I met humans, I would surely learn emotions. There was no doubt about it. So I had to find humans. I had to find someone soon, and actually talk with them. I left the town and continued walking. I was driven by an instinct much like a sense of duty, to meet a human. The degree of brightness in the gray skies quietly began to shift. No matter how far I walked, no matter how far I proceeded, nothing changed. Desolate earth as far as the eye could see. There was no shred of hope. Despite this, I walked. I walked to rid myself of the worry. I don't know how many days passed. I just kept on walking. I eventually reached the end of the supply of oral nutrient blocks I had taken from the factory. Despite this, I continued walking. Then I noticed my knees were on the ground. My body would not even accept the simple command to move my legs forward. I looked at my surroundings. Still nothing but the unchanged barren lands. The gray cloudy sky and the dry, stagnant wind. Have all the humans been wiped out? If so, then I... My vision gradually dimmed. The world in front of my eyes began to lose its color, and slowly went dark. I then collapsed face down into the reddish-brown earth, and I lost consciousness. The next thing I saw was once again the ceiling. However, this ceiling wasn't cold like the one at the facility I had been activated in. Although it had stains, likely due to its age, there was a kind of softness in the white walls and wooden beams that supported them. Where was I? Why was I here? Turning my head to the side, I saw desks, shelves, and the bed I was lying upon. The bed which was gently supporting me was quite soft, and had a sweet smell. I knew I had fallen on the devastated earth and lost consciousness. Did that mean someone had carried me to this place? Could it have been that I was carried by... As the thought passed through my head, I heard a noise. It was a small sound, almost small enough to miss, but I heard it. Putting my trust in the sound, I left the room. I followed the hallway that continued outside the door, and the sound grew louder. It was a voice with a mixture of a certain rhythm and intonation, a form of expression that humans called song. It was also a somewhat nostalgic singing voice. I had no memory of ever hearing it before. In fact, I did not have any memories to begin with, but somehow it felt nostalgic all the same. I then began to feel a slight warmth spread throughout my body. Feeling a warm sensation from a song was a strange thing. Strange. I knew it should be strange, and yet... What was it I was feeling? There was a warmth deep within my chest. Before I knew it, my feet were leading me towards the singing voice. The voice guided me to a big white door. The voice was then the loudest it had been. The owner of the voice was clearly behind this door. Laying my hands upon it, I slowly opened the door. On the other side of the door lay a chapel. It was an open space. Benches were evenly spaced throughout. There was multicolored stained glass. The singer was standing amidst the light that poured in through the window. Hands together as if in prayer was a lone human girl, singing. That strangely nostalgic melody. Somehow her warm voice had completely stopped my thinking. I simply stood there, lending my ear to the girl's song. Finished singing, the human girl slowly turned my way and smiled.
おかえりなさい.
Welcome home? I had replied without thinking, and the girl let out an embarrassed laugh.
ごめんなさい。旅に出てしまった兄とそっくりだったから、つい...
I look like your brother?
うん、とっても。オレンジ色でポワポワしてて、不愛想なところまでそっくり。
Orange? Poa poa? What do you mean?
こう、ポワポワって...
She attempted to explain with gestures, but I didn't understand. As I mulled over what she was saying, she gave a small laugh.
ごめんなさい。自己紹介がまだだったね。
She continued to smile as she walked toward me.
私はシオナ。この教会に住んでいるの。よろしくね。
Skip the voice line. どうしたの? The truth is, I don't remember anything. Where I'm from, who I am, I just don't know. Half truth, half lie.
そっか、 大変だったね。 だからあんなところで倒れてたんだ。
Now I think I'll end the part here. I'm planning each part to be about 20 minutes in length, so that you don't get bored and I don't get tired from speaking. Of course, the main reason I'm reading this visual novel is to, you know, practice my speaking pace and enunciation and stuff like that. Thank you very much for watching. Harmonia is available on Steam for... Normally, I think it's, $10. But right now, the summer sale is on, so it's on sale for about $4. Please be sure to pick it up, as it looks impressive thus far. I can't wholeheartedly recommend it, as I'm only in Chapter 1. But it's Ki. And Ki, as a name, carries a lot of weight in the visual novel industry. Again, thank you very much for watching. I'll see you next part. Hopefully this is somewhat comfy for you.